faculty philosophy journal was fortunate enough to have the confidence and faith of the faculty of philosophy to organize this event, and Robin and I would like to thank them again for that. When organizing the symposium, as Robin mentioned last night, we wanted to bring together a number of philosophers to speak today about various aspects of the intersection of philosophy and race. And we envisioned the event as a continuation of the issue of the GFPJ that we edited over the past 2 years. Our goal is to bring contributors to the journal into dialogue together with other scholars and philosophers of race. And this morning we have a panel on Kant. After lunch we'll have a panel on Du Bois and one on philosophy, contemporary philosophy and race later in the afternoon. Each of today's panels will be moderated by a young philosopher who addresses these issues in their work, either from the New School or outside. And I'll just take a minute to introduce the first panel. We have Charles Mills, who is the John Evans Professor of Moral and Intellectual Philosophy at Northwestern University. His 1997 The Racial Contract won the Myers Outstanding Book Award for the study of bigotry, and has remained an important text in the history of liberalism, politics, philosophy, and race. He's published very widely on issues of race and philosophy, engaging with traditions of Marxism and liberalism. His essay for our special issue, Kant and Race Redux, is a contribution to a lively debate on the role of race in Kant's philosophy, and we'll hear more about that today. Joining him is Robert Bernasconi, who is the Edwin Earl Sparks Professor of Philosophy and African American Studies at Penn State University. He too has published widely on race, Kant, and Sartre and existentialism, among other things. He's the editor of a number of collections of essays on the topic of race and philosophy, including Race and Racism in Continental Philosophy, which was published in 2003 with Indiana University Press. His contribution to our edition, Silencing the Hottentots, extends his historical analysis of race in the early modern period. Moderating today, we have Rehman Hussein, who is currently a graduate student in the Department of Philosophy at the New School. She came here after receiving an MA in Political Science from the Free University of Berlin. Her research focuses on Kant's theoretical philosophy, as well as feminist and anti-racist social philosophy. Her review of Sally Haslinger's book appears also in our issue. So please join me in welcoming them this morning.
Slowly making some impact, but I don't know how many more I have to publish before it makes a difference. This is the fourth time I've lectured at the New School, apparently. I guess you like this topic. I don't know why, but here we go again. I should explain that I'm, in talking about racism, I think about it very differently from the way a lot of philosophers think about it, and you hear it discussed. I don't think of racism either primarily as a set of beliefs or ideas. I don't think of it primarily as a set of attitudes. I think of it very much in the Fanonian Sartrean tradition as primarily a system, a material system built on social practices, and I inherit too the ideas of Stokely Carmichael and Charles V. Hamilton about institutional racism. So it comes, you need to understand that if you try to understand why I'm doing what I'm doing today with Kant and racism, even though in talking again about Kant, I'm not able to really get at the social practices and the way they operate that really interest me. But it does explain why I think it's important to come to these issues historically, and only historically, can you illuminate the existence of racist practices today, or institutionally within philosophy. But all of that, in a way, had already been said by Oliver Cromwell Cox 70 years ago. So that's not new. What happens when we look at the racism of a philosopher like Kant? It's clearly a mistake just to pick out individual fragments or sentences and try and assimilate those idea of racism, those racist statements, to some definition of racism that you brought already in advance. Just to give you a very, very simple example, which I think would need to be developed over many pages to before it becomes rigorous. You can think about the stereotype that he applies, that Africans are lazy, right? So this is a stereotype that he employs that had been in existence for decades, if not centuries, arose out of the way travelers would go to Africa and see Africans living a different lifestyle, and so people imbued with the Protestant work ethic would think of themselves as naturally superior to people who are not working as hard as they felt that they should be. Now that's one version of how this stereotype figures within an account. It takes on the same formulation, takes on a different meaning within the context of the institution of slavery, where the fact that the slave owners think of their African slaves as lazy justifies forms of punishment and a certain kind of treatment and a development of certain practices. Then again, when in the second half of the 18th century, for the first time, the institution of slavery is called into question at a broad level. Laziness comes to justify the institution. And you see Kant doing that in 1788 in the famous footnote, where Kant makes his most public intervention into the slavery debate of the times, where he supports slavery on the grounds that people of African descent will not work unless they are made to work. But what is different when Kant is using that argument in that context is that this is an essay. The essay is entitled On the Use of Teleological Principles in Philosophy, in which he is giving his third and most pronounced defense of the notion of race as a scientific concept. And as some of you may know, it's been my argument now since 1993 that Kant invented the scientific concept of race. It now, when he uses it in that context, he's not just saying that Africans, or people of African descent, tend to be lazy. He is suggesting that it is a permanent, inheritable characteristic of Africans that they are lazy and will not work, and that therefore, if they are to be productive, you need an institution like slavery. And this, therefore, is different, again, from the previous senses in which one might say Africans are lazy, because here it's attached to something akin to a racial essentialism, in the sense of something akin to a biological racial essentialism, which Kant, because of the status of the concept of race in his philosophy, doesn't quite embrace, but he is in some sense one of the first to present this view. Now in this talk I'm not going to rehearse my arguments about Kant's embrace of a scientific racism. I'll recap where the debate on Kant and race is, where I think it is, very briefly. I think it's generally accepted now that it is indisputable that Kant was a racist up until at least 1794. Pauline Kleingeld argues that Kant had second thoughts, unless you practice wishful thinking. Quite frankly, there's no indication that he ever dropped these racist ideas, but it seems to me he continues them. So I argued in a paper called Kant's Third Thoughts on Race that he thought, well, maybe the slave trade isn't such a good idea, but he never came out and published that thought. There are still philosophers who argue that Kant was a child of his time and his racist ideas. I have argued that far from being that, and my essay on Silence in the Hottentots is another example of this, I can show that Kant is actually introducing new forms of racism. And I want to insist that when I think about racism, I prefer to think about it, when I'm being rigorous, in the plural. You can't come up with a useful definition of racism, in my view. You have to think of a plurality of racisms intersecting, often contradicting each other. The question which is still open and which will remain open in perpetuity, I suspect, is how deeply Kant's philosophy is touched by this racism. This is something that Charles and I have often discussed and we fundamentally agree on. There's not going to be any argument about that, from this side of the table at least.
Deal in advance.
Yes, correct.
But don't ambush me, Bernasconi.
But obviously the trick is you redefine what you mean by Kant's philosophy, what's central and what's not. And for a certain style of philosophizing, that is easier to do than for those people who take the history of philosophy seriously. What I want to talk about today, though, is how Kant contributed to racist philosophies of history. In the first part of the 19th century, racism, the ideology of racism, if we want to use that expression, I don't often choose to do so. I don't know what it illuminates, but the ideology of racism is not so much connected with science. It's not based so much on biology. Biopolitical racism develops beginning in 1842 with Josiah Martin, and it becomes a movement throughout Europe in the 1870s and so on. But the philosophy of history in the early 19th century is primarily based on the philosophy of history. Races were not necessarily thought of as being based on biology, for example. And so that's a rather anachronistic way of looking at it. But to get into this debate, let's think about Kant's review of Herder. Herder had proposed in his great book on history an idea that all peoples contribute to the idea of humanity. And if any people dies out, or if any people loses its cultural, he wouldn't quite put it in those terms, but his cultural integrity, then all of humanity suffers. Kant thought this idea was completely implausible. This is why he raised against Herder the question, why do the Tahitians exist? or there's a wonderful old English translation which reformulates it as, why do the Tahitians bother to exist? Which I think captures much better the spirit of Kant. You know, these Tahitians, they are so lazy. They are like sheep, he says. You know, they're just happy, but what are they doing? They're not contributing anything. And he says the same thing about Greenlanders later. It presents a problem for him, but it's part of a larger problem that he formulated the year before in 1784, in his idea for Universal History of Cosmopolitan Intent, where he says that the question of individuals and nations can only be answered insofar as we can discover the purpose in nature behind the seemingly senseless course of human events. Kant offered an answer to this problem, but he himself admitted that his answer, though necessary, was puzzling. And it never lost this puzzling character for him. His answer was, earlier generations seem to perform their laborious tasks only for the sake of later ones, so as to prepare for them a further stage from which they can raise still higher the structure intended by nature. In other words, whereas plants and animals, in some sense, fulfill themselves in the present, human beings do not, because what gives meaning and sense to human existence is only defined by the species. And the cosmopolitan end, the cosmopolitan goal, he says, to which human history is directed. And it was in this context that he famously claimed, our continent, meaning Europe, will probably legislate for all other continents. Quite how puzzling this is for Kant is revealed by the fact that he has to keep returning to it, but that he never seems really as exercised as perhaps he should have been by the role in this cosmopolitan history that is to be played by races that have permanent, inheritable limits to them. Because if white people, who have, famously, as Kant says, all the talents, unlike the other races, it's clear that for white people, the slow development of man's original capacities can perhaps take them to this moral condition that is going to be found in this cosmopolitan whole, which will give meaning to the species. But what about these other races, which are not going to be able to fulfill themselves? He offers three different solutions at various times, which apply to different races and peoples, so it seems. One way of resolving the problem that he does entertain from time to time is that the supposedly inferior races will continue to occupy a servile role, as indeed he says the same of the lower classes. And this idea is found still in the 1790 Critique of Judgment. It's sort of central to his whole account of human fulfillment. A second way of resolving the contradiction is that the inferior races will die out. He actually seems to celebrate this idea in the context of Native Americans. He says at one point, What about the Native Americans? We could kill them, he says, but that would be cruel. They will probably kill each other. And he does from time to time talk about how Native Americans seem just to be disposed to go into war for the sake of going to war. He says that in his religion within the limits of reason alone. And then, of course, the third way is a possibility of some kind of assimilation or transformation which would be ruled out by his belief in permanent inheritable characteristics, but which he does seem to entertain from times in the case of Jews. And that's why I'm going to look a little at the discussion around Kant's anti-Semitism, which so far has largely been kept apart from Kant's, from the discussion of Kant's racism. Pauline Kleingart, in her book Kant and Cosmopolitanism, has one paragraph on Kant and Jews, which says, well, actually, you know, one of his best friends was a Jew. doesn't work now, didn't work then. So let me just turn to this debate, because I think it indicates another way of going about thinking the issues of racism and how to analyze it in terms of debates of the time. And the figure I want to introduce here, I don't know how well he is known he is in the New School, is Saul Asher. Saul Asher, born in 1767, was a Jew. His original name was Saul Ben Ashel Jaffer, and he was a Kantian. In 1791, he wrote a, 1792, he wrote a book called Leviathan, in which he attempted to give a Kantian account of religion, in which he tried to show how Judaism would be an exemplary religion from a Kantian viewpoint. In the same year, of course, Fichte, who was 4 years his senior, wrote his critique of Revelation, in which Judaism was dismissed rather hurriedly. And then the following year, 1793, Kant publishes Religion Within the Boundaries of Mere Reason. And in that place, clearly sides, it seems, with Fichte. Kant, you remember, writes, strictly speaking, Judaism is not a religion at all, but simply the union of a number of individuals who, since they belong to a particular stock, Stamm, establish themselves into a community under purely political laws, hence not into a church. Of course, there is for Kant only one religion, and there can only ever be one religion, just as there can only be one morality. This is because reason declares itself. Anyway, in 1793, that is, there's a lot happening in 1793, but in June, Fichte, drawing on Kant's book on religion, writes his contribution to the correction of the public verdict on the French Revolution. And as part of this book, he engages famously, I'm sure you know something about that here, in a dismissal of Judaism, which draws a response from Saul Asher in 1794 in a book entitled Eisenmenger der Zweite, Eisenmenger the Second. The first Eisenmenger, of course, was Johann Eisenmenger, who in 1700 wrote a book called Judaism Revealed. All the copies were burnt pretty much, but then it was reissued in 1711. It's a book of 2,100 pages. And in there he tries to detail everything he can find from Jewish sources against the Jews. And so it's actually still today used as a source book for our knowledge of Judaism, although it tends to be revived mainly by anti-Semites, as you can imagine. Anyway, Asher's argument is that just as Menger the First introduced a different form of hatred of the Jews by detailing it in a scholarly way and exposing the faults of their religion in their own words, Fichte introduces a new species of hatred of the Jews. Asher's argument is that Jew hatred has taken primarily two forms up until now. There is the religious form of the hatred of the Jews, and there is the political form of the hatred of the Jews. He wants to argue that Kant's form of hatred of the Jews, as expressed in the religion book, is the religious kind. So it's not new. Fichte starts off with the political kind, because Fichte argues that Judaism is a state within a state, and thus goes contrary to the interests of all the nations in which Jews live. But Fichte takes it a stage further and introduces a new form of hatred of the Jews, which Asher calls moral. It's a moral hatred of the Jews built on Kantian universalism. Just to give you some quotes from Fichte here, he says that the Jewish nation is so dreadful not because it is isolated and closely knit, but rather because it is founded on the hatred of mankind. And the reason why Fichte is talking about the Jews in the 1790s is because of the debate of the time. Just as Kant has having to intervene on the issue of African slaves in the 1780s, because that is the preeminent debate of the time in all the journals which Kant is reading, the debate in the 1790s is, should Jews be given civil rights? And Fichte argues they should be given human rights, but not civil rights. I see absolutely no way of giving them civic rights, he says, except perhaps if one night we chop off all of their heads and replace them with new ones in which there would not be a single Jewish idea. Now, this is in the context of the French Revolution. This is fixed. Now, what is interesting to me here is that Kant is exonerated by Asher as an old-style hater of the Jews, not one of the new-style haters of the Jews. And in fact, he recognizes that the seeds of Fichte's hatred of the Jews comes directly out of Kant. And he says that because Kant argues expressly in the religion book, as you know, that Jews treat all other peoples with hostility, and for that reason, they are treated with hostility. Now, if you're a lawyer, you are going to be able to say, yes, well, he's not saying you ought to treat Jews with hostility. He's just describing a fact. But if you're a historian of racism, you understand how this logic works. They treat people with hostility, and so we must find some way of dealing with them because they are obstacles to human progress, as Kant sees it. And just a few months after the publication of Fichte's book on the French Revolution, in a lecture series on the metaphysics of morals beginning in October 1793, Kant, who must surely have known Fichte's book, repeats his discussion of Judaism in the context of his celebration of cosmopolitanism. It's the very idea of cosmopolitanism which is infected by this hatred of the Jews. The trouble with the Jews, Kant says, are that they are congenitally not cosmopolitan. Among the Jews, he writes, all estimation for other men who are not Jews is totally lost, and goodwill is reduced merely to love of their own tribe, under which they are wont to cherish one another according to the principia adopted, and receive the more credit the more the agent approaches to a maximum of expediency, deals falsely, is lucky in turning a prophet, or possesses cleverness, cunning, and craft. Now, obviously, the repetition of the old stereotypes is not what is so interesting here as the fact that the difference between Fichte and Kant is very slight. It's coming from the same inspiration, the same belief in a moral cosmopolitan universalism, which in order that it should be established, all obstacles to it have to be removed. And so, in 1798, in the conflict of the faculties, you can see how this is all part of a piece. Kant calls, again, in the context of a discussion of the civic rights of Jews, he says they can only be awarded civic rights insofar as they convert to Christianity, to the moral religion, and we must look for a, and this is his phrase, as you know, a euthanasia of Judaism. So I think I need, for reasons of time, to move this towards a close. If I had more time, I would want to try and show how the same methodology can be, and these kinds of distinctions between different forms of racism, how new forms of anti-black racism operate in somewhat similar ways in Kant, in terms of his philosophy of history, as I've already tried to show elsewhere, they operate in terms of his science of racism. Just to take a shortcut, one of my students earlier this week had heard me talk about Fichte's remarks on the Jews, tried to look it up online, and the only place where you could find a discussion of it was in a website which also contained the article, Blacks Are Satanic and Their Culture is Evil. So the connection between anti-Semitism and anti-black racism, as Fanon tells us in Black Skin, White Mask, is very close. If you find an anti-Semite, you probably found an anti-black racist. The point, it seems to me, is that we should not be surprised that in the 1790s, the Jews are being castigated for not being cosmopolitan, and that 100 years, they are being castigated for being cosmopolitan. That's how these things work. You shouldn't be looking in the content of the idea, but you should be looking in the broader system of ideas as to how these racisms operate, what sustains them, what makes them necessary for the sustenance the creation and transformation of the existing power structures. But what is interesting to me too is that even though Asher was saying unambiguously that in his view the Kantian philosophy introduced a new unprecedented species of Jew hatred that was based on the alleged insistence of Jews to hate everybody else, Asher, like so many Kantians since, does not want to believe that Kant did help to introduce this new concept of hatred. He cannot bring himself to believe that. He cannot, because of his loyalty to a certain kind of reason that he believes is still necessary for bringing people out of certain kinds of dissension into a form of unity. But I think that what Asher's text shows is both that there is a serious problem with this moral form of cosmopolitanism, just as there is a serious problem with the notion of perpetual peace with which it is irredeemably associated. Just as when people go to war for the sake of peace, as opposed to the sake of some advantage, you have to totally eliminate your enemy because they are the enemies of humanity. So when you believe in a moral cosmopolitanism and you believe in a unity of human beings where there is no dissension, there is a tendency to want to believe that you have to eradicate those views that refuse this possibility and that the fate of all humanity depends on it. That is where Kantianism gets some of its self-righteousness from, and I believe it has no place in philosophy today.
My provocative title is Black Radical Kantianism. To explain the startling, if not outright oxymoronic title, some theoretical stage setting will be necessary. Retrieving Liberalism. In my 2005 essay, Kant's Untermenschen, and my more recent Kant and Race Redux, I argue that the most illuminating way to treat Kant's and other Enlightenment philosophers' racist views is as an organic part of his, their overall philosophy, rather than as anomalies easily ignored or cleared off. I won't repeat what I already said there. Instead, I will turn to another issue. What is the appropriate philosophical response to the discovery of such racist or sexist framing theoretical assumptions in the work of major theorists? We could distinguish three main options. Number one, continue as before, since it will be claimed contemporary use of the theory was already racially and gender inclusive anyway. Number two, reject the theory as irretrievably contaminated. Number three, try to retrieve the theory in a self-consciously rethought and reconstructed form, sensitive to and correcting for the race and gender exclusions and differential treatments justified by the theory, that is, in its actual non-sanitized form. The first is based on the approach of mainstream philosophers. Yes, X was a racist slash sexist, which is certainly unfortunate, but it doesn't affect the theory. So after appropriate footnote, and maybe a brief minute silence, the second is the strategy of many radicals. One rejects the theory as irretrievable probably male or white or heterosexist or Eurocolonial, and seeks theoretical resources elsewhere. Radical feminism in its different versions, black nationalism, queer theory, post-colonial theory, etc. The third has perhaps its best known current exemplification in the feminist liberal project, although social democratic liberalism can be seen as an earlier class-based attempt to treat liberalism for the left. Now, my own strategy in recent years, which I've claimed elsewhere would still be pretty radical in its implications, has been the third, to take feminist liberalism as a model and self-consciously apply its approach to race. Because of the underrepresentation of people of color in the profession, this set of issues and debates will probably be unfamiliar to most white philosophers unless they have self-consciously set out to inform themselves on the subject. As Alexis Deander and Robin Mueller comment in their Philosophy and Race preface, many of the philosophers ask and answering questions on the relation between philosophy and race are doing so on the margins of mainstream academic publishing. But obviously, the desideratum is that this situation changed. So one of the virtues of my strategy, though it could be outweighed if the costs are too high, as my critics would claim, is that it should facilitate such a mainstreaming of these issues, thereby contributing both to their de-ghettoization and, one hopes, to the eventual transformation of a very segregated and white discourse with little appeal or relevance to the now nearly 40%, according to Wikipedia, of the US population who count as people of color, assuming Euro Latinos are included. Liberalism has historically been the dominant political philosophy in the country. So reframing the matter as a principal challenge to the exclusion of contemporary liberalism should, at least in theory, exert greater pressure on contemporary liberals, both in philosophy and more generally, to defend themselves. If you're a good liberal, how come you're not talking about this? So feminist liberals begin by proposing that we reconceive liberalism in its hegemonic forms as not merely liberalism simpliciter, liberalism qua liberalism, but a contingent form of liberalism that developed the way it did because of male domination, patriarchal liberalism. This move enables a cognitive distancing that makes it possible to see certain theoretical choices, conceptual mappings, gaps and silences, prescriptions and prohibitions as attributable to a male gender agenda, rather than as necessary implications of liberalism as such. One can then ask, what would a liberalism genuinely committed to the flourishing of all individuals, female as well as male, look like? Similarly, I have argued that the inadequacies on race of hegemonic forms of liberalism have been attributable to the fact that it has been a racial liberalism. And somewhat comparable here to University of Chicago political theorist Jennifer Pitts, Imperial Liberalism, in her book of A Turn to Empire, The Rise of Imperial Liberalism in Britain and France. And this racial liberalism develops organically out of its shaping by European expansionism, colonial rule, and white settlement. Since its historic purpose has generally been to rationalize and justify these processes, we should not be surprised to find that its contemporary descendants, though nominally de-raced, have overall been unhelpful in overturning white domination. Nonetheless, as with feminist liberals, I am analogously claiming that a race-sensitive and reconstructed liberalism capable of addressing ongoing racial subordination can indeed be the best. Now, my treatment will be oriented by the African-American experience, and as such, it is not supposed to be coextensive with anti-racist liberalisms in general, given the different varieties of racism to which other ethno-racial groups have been subject. But presumably, there should be enough commonalities to render it more broadly illuminating. And of course, the long-term goal would not be a competitive interest group politics, but a principled, deliberative democracy integration with these other possible revisionist versions of liberal theory. Black radical liberalism. So a term increasingly used to refer to African-American and sometimes Afro-diasporic political theory in modernity is Afro-modern political thought. See Bob's In the Shadow of the Bodies, Afro-modern political thought in America. But this term covers a range of positions, including black conservatism. And what I'm looking for, obviously, are progressive candidates. black radical liberalism is an attempt to reconstruct from different and usually counterposed bodies of political thought what I see as the most promising candidate for an emancipatory African-American political theory. So I'm less concerned with the question of whether any African-American political theorists actually self-consciously identified what they were doing under this designation than the question whether it stands up to criticism as a hopeful way forward. So in taxonomies of African-American slash black political thought, for example, as you find in Michael Dawson's work, the standard contrast would be between black liberalism, which is mainstream, and black radicalism, which is fringe. For example, black nationalism and black Marxism. And what I'm arguing for is a synthesizing, reconstructed black liberalism, which draws upon the most valuable insights of the black nationalist and black Marxist traditions, and incorporates them into liberalism, which would now be grammatically transformed. So the taxonomies would now be drawn differently, with black liberalism subsuming different varieties, the mainstream variety with which we're familiar, and a new black radical version. And this now is where Immanuel Kant comes in, as one of the three key theorists for this projected reconstruction, if in somewhat unusual company. So key theorists, Immanuel Kant, idealist and racist liberal, Karl Marx, materialist but class reductionist and racist class theorist, and W.E.B. Du Bois, critical race theorist. So the contributions can be seen as falling neatly under these three components. For the liberalism, we go to Kant. For the black part, we go to Du Bois. And for the radical part, of course, we go to both Marx and Du Bois. Question then, how does black radical liberalism differ from black mainstream liberalism? By definition, they are both liberal, endorsing liberalism as a political philosophy, but black radical liberalism seeks to transform liberalism to make it responsive to the alternative realities of the black diasporic experience in modernity, and the corresponding necessary reordering of liberal normative priorities. So black radical liberalism, quote one, recognizes white supremacy as central to the making of the United States, and more sweepingly the modern world, and two, seeks the rethinking of the categories, crucial assumptions, and descriptive and normative frameworks of liberalism in the light of that recognition. Black mainstream liberalism, on the other hand, either one, refuses to recognize white supremacy, for example, by endorsing what is called the anomaly view of US racism, classical discourse by Roger Smith in his prize-winning civic ideals, or two, if it does give lip service to its reality, assumes nonetheless that the categories, crucial assumptions, and descriptive and normative frameworks of liberalism can be adopted with little change to the task of getting rid of it. The importance of liberalism, most successful political philosophy of modernity, and now, as we know, globally hegemonic, most developed body of normative theory for the rights of persons and the conceptualization of social justice. Importance of Marxism, presumably not much need to emphasize that in this setting. Most developed Western oppositional critique of liberalism and analysis of the materialist undermining of liberalism's ideals by the workings of capitalism. And of course, main ancestor of critical theory. Importance of critical race theory. Corrects both Western liberalism's and Western Marxism's failure to recognize and theorize the centrality of race and white supremacy to the making of the modern world, and the implications for normative theory, personhood, gender, rights, materialism, capitalism, and what needs to be subjected to emancipatory critique to achieve social justice. So the key claim, in bold, liberalism's ideals, the flourishing of the individual, the repudiation of a restrictive hierarchy, are very attractive, but are necessarily undermined by racial white supremacist capitalism. The traditional mistake of the white left in its critique has been to focus just on the class dimension of capitalism and the role only of class exploitation in the shaping of the modern world, and not give sufficient attention to the racial dimensions of both. So the competing ontology that classical Marxism and later critical theory offers is fundamentally flawed, and its serious theorization of social justice needs to correct this omission. black radical Kantianism will thus be the main normative tool in theorizing a revisionist deontological liberalism informed in a way that mainstream Kantianism obviously is not by the realities of white supremacist capitalism. Objections and replies. But how can Marxist and liberal insights be reconciled? Aren't they necessarily opposed? Well, as we know, liberalism comes in different varieties, and black radical liberalism would obviously be a left-wing variety. Liberalism is opposed to state-commanded socialism, but state-commanded socialism has proved itself to be a historical failure, both economically and morally. Liberalism is not in principle opposed to social democracy, as shown most obviously by John Rawls's work, or market socialism, or worker control, or various other left alternatives. But how can black nationalist insights be reconciled either with Marxism or liberalism? Well, black nationalism likewise comes in different varieties. The key insight of the tradition, in my opinion, is the recognition of the reality and centrality of an ontology of race and how it shapes people and their psychology, which can be accommodated in a modified Marxism and liberalism. Obviously, this means rejecting essentialist versions of black nationalism, whether anti-theological or culturalist, and a black Marxist, going back to Cedric Robinson, a left nationalist tradition has long existed that addresses these issues. And Lucius, on race and philosophy, critical social in the interest of black folk, discusses such issues. Thomas Shelby's We Who Are Dark offers a reconciliation of liberalism with one variety of black nationalism. But aren't Kantianism in particular, and liberalism in general, based on an ontology of individuals? So how could groups presupposed by Marxism and black nationalism, classes and races, be part of the picture? Kantianism and liberalism are committed to moral individualism, that is, individuals as the locus of value. They're not committed to descriptive individualism, that is, individuals as necessarily atomic individuals. A theorization of oppression generally, and also oppression in future liberal states in the West, focus here, requires that we locate these individuals as members of groups in relations of domination and subordination. And some feminist liberals, such as Anne Codd, in her Analyzing Oppression, have begun the self-conscious theorization of such a social ontology. And a great deal of progressive criticism of liberalism, going back at least to Marxism, is predicated on the assumption that liberalism is necessarily committed to an atomic individualist ontology. But while this may be true of ideal theory, liberalism, that is liberal theory for human beings interrelating under just circumstances, it should be obvious that it cannot be true for non-ideal theory, liberalism, that is liberal theory for human beings interrelating under conditions of structural oppression. This is arguably the real source of the problem. A liberalism originally formulated just by and for bourgeois white males, social privilege, which was then nominally extrapolated so as to include the social subordinated, but with no recognition of the accompanying need to change the official ontology to register their radically different social location. But, turning to race and Kant specifically, don't mainstream Kantians already, whether aware of Kant's racist texts or not, use Kantianism in a racial inclusive way? So how would this be any different? We need to differentiate, as just indicated, nominal racial inclusion from substantive racial inclusion. Classic references, Susan Muller-Okin's famous discussion in the Introduction to Justice, Gender and the Family, of the difference between false and substantive gender neutrality in the writings of the male justice theorists of her time. Substantive racial inclusion would require that the radically different history and structural position of blacks in the polity and the normative ontology of the society be taken into account and suitably incorporated through the appropriate modifications of the apparatus. But insofar as Kantianism is predicated on our duties to a moral community of persons, and blacks are persons, why would any such modification be needed? Because the history of modernity is one in which most persons, and certainly black persons, have not had their personhood recognized. So the moral community has been divided between persons recognized as persons, also known as persons, also known as white folks, and persons not recognized as persons, subpersons. In particular, white supremacist societies, such as but not limited to the United States, have been founded on a rules and basic structure predicated on the racial denial of equal personhood to people of color. So the implications of the categorical imperative in such a society, both for individual person-to-person interactions and for a collective duty to transform, if you'll forgive the Jamaican German, the Rassenschaft into the Reichsschaft, and correct for this past history and its ongoing legacy, are very dramatic indeed. But hasn't all of this really been covered already, albeit in a different vocabulary, in the long continental tradition exploring the relation between self and other? Well, even if it has, the appropriate corrective prescriptions have not generally been translated into an Anglo-analytic liberal framework, which is where I'm trying to intervene. And at least some black continental theorists, such as Lewis Gordon, have argued that it really hasn't, because the other of these European discourses is really the white other, the white woman, the white worker, the white Jew, and that blacks, as occupying the distinctive location of a slave race in modernity, are actually ontologically positioned below the other. Consider, for example, Hannah Arendt's generally problematic and sometimes clearly racist characterizations of blacks in her writings, as recently very well organized by Catherine Gaines in her critique, Hannah Arendt and the Negro Question. Finally, don't such claims take us into an unproductive and divisive race to the bottom, an oppression sweepstakes? I am more oppressed than thou. And avoiding political division among progressives is certainly a desideratum, but it shouldn't come at the expense of truth. And it shouldn't come at the expense of an objective investigation of what the actual historical experience of blacks has been, for example, with white feminism and with white left. There's a long and happy history here which needs to be acknowledged rather than papered over, since ignoring it would only perpetuate the problem. Okay, so what would black radical Kantianism imply for the rethinking of Kantian theory, for everyday moral interactions and political philosophy? Well, here are some tentative thoughts. Rethinking individual moral transactions. A materialist Kantianism would not be amoral or given to realpolitik, but it would recognize the extent to which, as material beings, we're embedded and embodied with what counts as inclination, just famously to be resisted, being heavily shaped by group membership. Likewise, what counts as genuine universalization will require far more moral effort to preserve. Materialism in this context means recognizing the difficulty of escaping both cognitively and motivationally empirical causation and the necessity of devising appropriate protocols and schedules of virtues to correct for it, as for example with implicit bias. Correspondingly, the formal partitioning between persons and subpersons has the virtue of tracking the realities both moral and immoral more accurately and alerting us to moral dangers, prescribing attentiveness to what factors are likely to make a difference and what our appropriate response should be. It introduces asymmetries into the standard person-to-person relationship presupposed by mainstream contemporary Kantianism, which either fails to acknowledge the difference made by race or gender, or assumes that can easily be subsumed into a generic respect. The different positioning of the groups means that we have four different interpersonal relationships: person to person, person to subperson, subperson to person, and subperson to person. And two different self relationships, one's respect for oneself as a recognized person, or one's respect for oneself as a non-recognized subperson. The question then becomes, how are these relationships likely to have been negatively shaped by white racial domination, and what corrections would be necessary to custom design a respect normatively appropriate to the specifics of the situation? So under this category, under this broad rubric of personhood theory, mainstream or non-mainstream, we would now have a common conceptual denominator, a lingua franca, to unite two kinds of philosophical investigations, largely separate, with one not even recognized as philosophical. From this revisionist perspective, we would then be able to see famous black theorists the 19th and 20th centuries, such as Frederick Douglass, Anna Julia Cooper, W.B. Du Bois, Marcus Garvey, Franz Fanon et al., as being, inter alia, major contributors to what could now be termed philosophical personhood theory under non-ideal conditions. So the fight with COVID, when and where I enter, Blacks as a tertium quid, a race without respect, the zone of non-being, all that stuff, which in a people in the black and in an African American tradition know, these can now be seen as interventions, the sort of the assertion of personhood in the situations where your person is an operative lens. Because socially recognized personhood is generally taken as a default mode, this work is not normally granted philosophical status, but that we can now appreciate is because our tacit reference format has been white males. Likewise, whiteness could now come under the black radical Kantian gates. Whiteness as a subject appropriate for philosophers is still relatively marginal, though the industrious energizer figure of George Yancey, book every 6 months, has industrial books. By the time I finish this talk, George will have another book. What white looks like, black bodies, white gazes, look a white self-criticality beyond anti-race, and as I said, the book coming out at the end of this talk. Translated into this new vocabulary, we can now reconceptualize whiteness in Kantian terms as occupation of the hair-invoked slot in person-to-sub-person relations, with the likely corollary generation of what Marilyn Fry famously calls whitely inclinations, and a related proneness, depending on the time period, to miscognize the actual demands of universalization, originally in an overtly racist period as coextensivity with the white population, now in a nominal post-racist period, now part of the putative color blindness, which is simultaneously underpinned by implicit bias, but in both cases wrong. The growing body of literature by white progressives, reflecting on their attempts to purge themselves of whiteliness, can thus be given a respectable philosophical translation. The corrective demands of race-inclusive personhood, when self and other respect have historically been predicated on one's superiority to non-white subpersons, which have been fused in an intimate and integral constituent of one's self-concept and identity, the price of the ticket in James Baldwin's famous formulation, and corresponding, of course, for subpersons who have internalized their lesser moral standing, the achievement of genuine self-respect and a relation of equality, rather than as to be deferred to superiors, a relation of equality to whites, will also require dramatic moral transformation, and can also be recognized as a topic long familiar and extensively theorized in the black diaspora tradition. Finally, consider what treating someone as a mere means would now come to. It is not merely a matter of rethinking familiar, discrete, person-to-sub-person transactions to make sure that they are fair, but of asking oneself about the extent to which one's everyday life the socially recognized white person, insofar as this life rests historically and currently on structural advantage and the refusal of equal opportunities to others, to ask oneself, insofar as this involves the exploitation of subpersons, what are the moral implications? If one benefits from social institutional structures founded on the denial of the equal person of people of color, the refusal to recognize equal humanity in them, one is arguably merely by participating in these structures without seeking their dismantling, carrying on the anti-Kantian using of these people. Insofar as modernity has been established on the basis of racial subordination, this rethinking would thus imply a dramatic revisioning of what it would take to achieve the kingdom of ends. Finally, rethinking political philosophy. And that takes us naturally to political philosophy, whose official subject matter since Rawls has been the justice of society's basic structure, and to which, of course, Immanuel Kant is also central. Now, Rawls's prescribed starting point was ideal theory, the derivation of the principles of justice for an ideal, well-ordered society, conceived of as a cooperative venture for mutual advantage, in which the rules are designed for everyone's benefit, and people in general follow the rules, that is, strict compliance. But, of course, the primary concern of black radical liberalism and black radical Kantianism as its normative tool is racial justice, which falls under the category of corrective justice for non-ideal societies, since arguably a well-ordered society would not even have races as social existence. Specifically, black radical liberalism wants to see the history of African slavery and subsequent black racial subordination in nominally post-emancipation conditions acknowledged and addressed, not just in the USA, but in the Americas more generally. After all, there could hardly be a clearer violation than chattel slavery of Kantian prohibitions on using people as mere means. memo. This is, of course, a sanitized Kant, not the actual Kant. He said, go for it. Give advice on how to meet needles. Hence the comparative moral epistemic privilege of the standpoint of blacks in modernity, and why a black radical Kantianism would be so revolutionary in its implications for the current world order. The relation between slavery, capitalism, and modernity is an old theme in the black radical tradition. Eric Williams's Capitalism and Slavery dates all the way back to 1944. Du Bois's Black Reconstruction to 1935. But the point is that a growing body of mainstream scholarship at the most respectable academic institutions, for example, Harvard, is now beginning to take this issue seriously. And a quote here from Harvard historian Sven Beckert's article, which appeared in the December 19th Chronicle of the Chronicle of Higher Education, but it gives a useful overview of the sort of emerging body of work in this field. So Beckert writes, the world we live in cannot be understood without coming to terms with the long history of capitalism. And no issue among US historians of capitalism currently attracts more attention than related to capitalism and slavery. No other national story raises the question with quite the same urgency as the history of the United States. The quintessential capitalist society of our time, it also looks back on long complicity with slavery. But the topic goes well beyond one nation. The relationship of slavery and capitalism is in fact one of the keys to understanding the origins of the modern world. And a global perspective allows us to comprehend in new ways how slavery became central to the Industrial Revolution. Europe's ability to industrialize rested at first entirely on the control of expropriated lands and enslaved labor in the Americas. We cannot know if the cotton industry was the only possible way into the modern industrial world, but we do know that was the path to global capitalism. We need to remember that the world Westerners forged was characterized by vast confiscation of land and labor, huge state intervention in the form of colonialism, and the rule of violence and coercion. The next time we walk the streets of Lower Manhattan, intent, or the grounds of Harvard University, we should think at least in passing of the millions of enslaved workers who helped make some of that grandeur possible, and to the ways that slavery's legacy persists today, end of quote. In other words, unpaid black labor and colonial exploitation more broadly is a central foundation of the modern world. This is the actual history and the set of actual historic injustices that is ignored in contemporary justice theory, both American and global, above all in the white fantasy world of Rawlsianism. The promise in the opening pages of Rawls's theory of justice was that having developed ideal theory, we're going to move on, no adequate conception equipped to non-ideal theory, including the matters of, and here I'm quoting Rawls, compensatory justice. But 40 plus years later, the transition has yet to take place. So a short list, whiteness of Rawls and for the most part, Rawlsianism. Prioritizing of ideal theory, which automatically excludes racial justice. Explicit concession in his last book is principles of justice are not meant to apply to racist societies. Starting point in theory of justice of society as a closed system isolated from other societies, which preempts any discussion of how colonialism shapes both the colonizing power and colonized. Original failure in theory of justice to cite race as an identity behind it. Failure to recognize race as a transnational structure. Failure to mention the Atlantic slave trade in any of his work. Failure to mention Native Americans in any of his work. Failure to condemn or even mention European imperialism and colonialism. Thomas Pogge's phrase, explanatory nationalism, to account for differential national development. Eurocentric cartography and periodization of modernity. Failure to acknowledge the racism of the actual overlapping consensus of Western values in modernity. And above all, and most strikingly, considering that this is the go-to guy of American justice theory for decades, failure to discuss in his work or even mention, the phrase never appears, affirmative action, the most important post-war measure of racial justice in the United States. Nor are these exclusions ancient history have long since begun to be corrected. The latest entry in this Jim Crow vision of justice, the Black and Companion to Rawls, edited by John Mandel and David Reedy, has out of nearly 600 pages, exactly a page and a half on race, and even that is unconnected to any theoretical rethinking. Affirmative action, a single one sentence and not in another end. Hence imperative of developing a black radical liberalism and a black radical Kantianism to challenge white justice theory and its general complicity with racial injustice. So key areas of rethinking. Overarching framework, non-ideal theory. Theoretical focus, ill-ordered societies. Social ontology, races and relations of domination and subordination. Social epistemology, aimed at combating dominant group ideation. Actual dominant variety of liberalism, racial. So black radical liberalism is going to require de-racializing racial liberty. The normative orientation is going to corrective justice. So this obviously is a summary of a larger problem. So ideal versus non-ideal theory, for population historically subordinated through slavery, colonialism, and Jim Crow, non-ideal is going to be the imperative. So black radical liberalism is going to be a variety of non-ideal theory, and as such, it's going to be a liberalism designed to give the overcoming of social oppression and liberal society. Rawls suggests we think of societies as cooperative ventures of mutual advantage. But a white supremacist state is not a cooperative venture of mutual advantage. So black radical liberalism rejects such a stipulation, focusing instead on real-world, ill-ordered societies, coercive rather than cooperative ventures, characterized by exploitation and asymmetries of respect rather than mutual advantage and reciprocal respect. The social ontology of an ill-ordered oppressive society will be very different from the social ontology of a well-ordered society. And the main obstacles to veridical cognition will accordingly not be individual originating bias, but dominant group ideologies, in this case, whiteness, white ignorance, etc. So you can sort of then appeal to the Kantian norm of publicity, as we now say transparency, valorized by liberal states, and sort of central problem is then going to be sort of overcome this obstacle, whiteness, white ignorance, racial liberalism. Because liberalism, its most influential incarnations in such societies, would not have been floating stratospherically aloft, untouched by group interests, but would have been fundamentally molded by them. As a liberalism needs critique and rethinking in keeping with the principled counter-repudiation of reasons of state. In the original incarnation, such liberalisms will have been overtly racist, with blacks being framed as subpersons. So from our present perspective, they'll be readily diagnosed as such. But contemporary racial liberalisms can fly under the radar, through no longer having such overt identifiers, but still normatively centering whites. Usually through a putatively racial inclusive abstraction that is in reality color-coded. So obviously a black radical Kantianism needs to expose such liberalisms for what they really are, as tools of the Rassenstaat and as obstacles to achieving the Reichstag. Finally, corrective justice. Kant, as with most liberal theorists leading up to his time, had little to say even about distributive justice as a norm. And my former colleague, University of Illinois, Samuel Fleischacker's very illuminating book, A Short History of Distributive Justice, makes a case that in fact distributive justice, a sort of generally human inclusive concept, is really a part of the past 200 years or so. But what we do know is that on one particular variety of non-ideal theory, punishment, Immanuel Kant is a hardliner. Society is about to dissolve, you make sure you unlock the cell and you execute the last murderer before everybody takes off for the new planet or whatever. Black radical Kantianism would therefore, in the spirit of this reconstructed and black non-ideal theory Kant, be equally uncompromising in its commitment to correcting the myriad violations of personhood of white supremacy and its legacy. So I don't have that much call for Latin in Jamaica, so this is probably pronounced wrong. Fiat justitia ruat can. See, not oxymoronic at all.
And that sounds to me still like ideal theory, since the terms themselves are ideal. I understand by non-ideal theory that there are no ideal terms that are not connected to their negative. So I understand the notion of non-ideal theory to mean what we mean by freedom is non-slavery. What we mean by universality is the inclusion of particular groups of people at a particular time. And that Kant buried this in his thinking. So he says, treat everyone as ends in themselves. And then you want to say, well, what on earth is an end in themselves? And you get the bad theory, I think, rational autonomy. The right answer is, you do not treat an individual as a thing. You do not treat them as a mere means. You do not put a price on them so you can buy and sell them. Without those terms, all of which refer to slavery, the notion of ends in themselves would be meaningless. Hence, it seems to me that non-ideal theory is one that understands that our ideals are embedded in that history and that we do not have any affirmative terms without that history of corrections. Otherwise, what you're doing is saying what we need, you know, is to be more sensitive in our application of universality. And that just seems to me to be the wrong, that seems to me still Kantianism, still believing in ideal morality. That writes out the history of freedom that would be empty without the history of the relationship to slavery. And
sure,
of course, this is Orlando Patterson wrote three volumes arguing this. I mean, I don't know what to say. This is not my book, this is Orlando Patterson's.
Absolutely. And I am fellow Jamaican, I'd say quickly. Okay, so by non-ideal theory, I mean, of course, normative theory under non-ideal conditions.
Right.
And the particular area I'm sort of focused on here is justice is going to fall under corrective justice. And you know, for that, I've subsumed a lot of different terms, rectificator, compensator, restorative, and so forth. And the claim would be that it's not necessarily going to sort of straightforward matter of, you know, applying ideal to non-ideal circumstances, in part because the kind of cognitive work you're going to have to do to understand what the appropriate application is often going to be underdetermined. So people have been enslaved, you can free them, that's a fairly straightforward case. When you think of more complicated cases, such as in gender subordination and what counts as the emancipation of women, and sort of treating women equally, or, I mean, just think of sort of dialogues have been about things like, you know, sexual harassment and objectification of women. You get all kinds of complications there. I mean, it could be not actually disagreeing. You get complications there which you can't just sort of derive in a sort of, in a straightforward algorithmic sense from the ideals, because, you know, the sort of, you know, non-ideal reality throws up, you know, moral complexities of its own. So my basic argument is that we need to develop non-ideal theory as kind of normative theory, and that it doesn't seem to me inappropriate to sort of harness Kantianism to this task insofar as it's the most powerful body of normative theory for personhood. So we sort of accept sort of centrality of personhood, respect for personhood as attractive ideals for modernity. Interesting question then becomes, what would such, or does such respect sort of translate into what kind of, you know, corrections and sort of, you know, restorative, rectificator, all that sort of stuff, not just material, does Thomas McCarthy and the others that I'm sure you read in political theory, sort of symbolic aspect of rectifications. These very interesting questions have not for the most part been dealt with by philosophers, and certainly not by Rawlsians, who have remained in the sort of Rawls land of ideal theory. So I guess I don't see why it's illegitimate to sort of, you know, see that as a project, considering that justice, and certainly the lay conception of justice would be, what is social justice? Social justice, correction of injustices. Whereas Rawlsians have turned it into this almost aesthetic body of thought detached from practical reason, where you sort of map out the ideals, but then never ask yourself, what are the bridging concepts to sort of bring those ideals into contact with the real world, and then say, well, here's a path to more just social order.
Oh, rethinking critical philosophy. Heading is rethinking individual moral transactions. You didn't write rethinking moral philosophy. You wrote rethinking individual moral transactions.
Right.
And then in that connection, bottom of page 7, you give some detail as to what rethinking of those transactions might be. But it seems to me that that in evaluating the transactions that you spell out there, one might just say, okay, you know, the best way to evaluate them is in terms of a Kantianism that emphasizes our duties to a moral community of persons. So in other words, it doesn't seem to me that what you argue under the rubric of rethinking individual moral transactions demands a rethinking of a Kantian moral philosophy, which is to say then that you really haven't answered objection Roman numeral 5 at the top of page 6. To give more of a slogan to it, and again to pick up on what Jay is saying, I mean, given that you, if you do want to move more in the direction of institutional concreteness, which the discussion of institutional and relational and practical, I mean, you know, what's actually going on in terms of individual transactions as mediated by practices and institutions, if that's really the direction you want to go in terms of moral philosophy and just not making us more richly aware of these transactions, why not, as it were, press on to Hegel, you know, leave Kant behind?
It has to do basically with a kind of strategic decision, which is that liberalism is hegemonic, so an intervention in liberal theory is going to have more impact than an intervention elsewhere. As you know, ever since Rawls, Kantian liberalism, deontological liberalism, has been the dominant variety. Certainly we can draw on other bodies of thought, but insofar as the attempt to try to sort of engage with mainstream folks and try to convert mainstream folks, I won't retain Kant, even as a sanitized and cleaned up Kant, you know, as the central figure. Now, insofar as I'm sort of taking account of social recognition of personhood, not just personhood, you could say I'm sort of, whether I like it or not, I'm sort of striking Hegelian notes. And you know, certainly in the overall, you know, sort of development of the line of argument, when you draw on this body of thought, I mean, if you draw on people like Fanon and Du Bois, you are in a sense drawing on this body of thought anyway. But I'm trying to keep it under Kantian rubric because, as I say, of the sense that Kant has been so central to sort of Rawls and analytic liberal political philosophy. And if you can sort of engage with these folks and say, there's a good Kant, there's a good liberal, there's a good Rawls, then you should be sort of open to this. I want to sort of get that kind of moral leverage that comes from
that's
position.
A strategic answer. It's not a philosophical or social theoretic answer.
Well, insofar as it's non-ideal theory, it has the connotations both of looking at social justice under non-ideal circumstances, but it also has, you know, the question of how do we help to practically bring this stuff into existence? In other words, part of the whole point is to get these, you know, debates out of the academy, out of the new school, where the location that it is, onto the streets, and the way you do that is by asking yourself strategic questions as well. Now, it should not, of course, be the case that strategic questions override in an unprincipled way the particular line of argument you're going to take. But the line of argument you can take, I think, is underdetermined. And if you can have a line of argument that is both sort of rough in a Kantian ballpark, at the same time has a way of sort of hooking on to sort of motivational questions, given where most people's heads are, I think that's a legitimate point in its favor.
I have a point that's similar to the one which has been made, and it speaks to your appropriation of Kant's moral philosophy.
I'm sorry, it's with?
And it speaks to your appropriation of Kant's moral philosophy and how the idea that we have equal moral worth is translated into recognition within social institutions. I mean, and you seem to be holding on to the idea of personhood, but that strikes me as extremely legalistic, and at some point, and your normative framework, I think, in turn becomes deeply tied to the state, right? Because the state is what recognizes you as having worth vis-a-vis your humanity. And I think there's also a point to be made about citizenship. But in any case, at some point, you also even mentioned deliberative democracy, right? And so that seems to speak to the way that we're incorporating the public realm within the modern state. But I wonder if we're talking about the substantial normative transformation of other social institutions, for example, civil society and the family, we're going to need richer normative concepts. Something that, for example, just saying that we have equal moral worth the way Kant does isn't going to satisfy.
Yes, but you see, that doesn't have to be the end point. I sort of see this as sort of a central point, kind of umbrella point, insofar as, you know, sort of tied to my overarching claim. That, you know, in terms of mainstream sort of narratives of modernity, you saw people tend to sort of, you know, assume a sort of, you know, presumptively recognized personhood, whereas in fact, personhood is only recognized for sort of small proportion of the population. And I focused on race here, but of course, you could say white women are recognized as full persons either. So I'm saying that, you know, simply trying to sort of work this set of concepts and to sort of say, well, what would it take for people who have not historically been recognized as full persons to achieve their personhood? What kinds of transformations would it take? And I certainly did not mean sort of limited to a narrow legal thing at all. I mean, the whole point is, in part, moral transformation, including moral transformation of the recognized persons. People have been privileged by the system, have been white males, it's going to require transformation of them, it's going to require transformation of the kind of everyday interactions. You know, they're supposed to be much broader than just sort of state relations. Law is supposed to cover a lot of civil society stuff as well. So my argument would be that you need this as a sort of basic prerequisite to get a lot of these questions off the ground, but it doesn't mean that in a lot of other details from other areas cannot be filled in later. It does seem to me that, you know, this is a sort of very useful strategic point as far as person is the central category, and by sort of partitioning personhood to recognized and non-recognized personhood, you can then get a lot of leverage out of that.
Robert, I'm sure you've heard this objection before, but you know, I mean, as you know, Lowick would argue that Kant's philosophy of history is a thin secularization of the Christian idea of providence. And maybe not just Kant's philosophy of history, but philosophy of history core. And I wonder if this you laid the idea. I mean, Kant has this idea of a numinal course of history, which ends in a homogenization. But it's a deeply Christian idea, at least since St. Paul, neither Jew nor Gentile. It's explicitly in Dante, in the Monarchia, you have the idea of a cosmopolitan political regime. So I guess the question is, why do you lay the dark side of this, and certainly there is a dark side, at the feet of Kant, rather than recognizing in Kant a chapter in the history of the Christian idea of eschatology? And as far as the paradigms of there being people who somehow don't fit into this, that seems to me one could think of as secularization of the grotesque Christian idea of predestination. Augustine says it quite explicitly that God gives his grace to some of us. Maybe the ultimate end of the Christian eschatology is to become a Broadway musical, where they.
I think I was following you up to that point. So does that mean I should sing my answer, or performative dance? I have no idea where that came from.
There is a musical on the Book of Revelation.
Okay, right, I see. I think Kant's conception of a moral religion owes a great deal to Christianity, is indisputable, in spite of his protests to say that that is not how it should be understood. But it seems a dangerous moment. There is the secularization. I mean, there are certainly dangerous features about certain forms of Christian eschatology, for example, the forms of millennialism have their dangers. But I think those dangers are distinct from the specific dangers when you say, we're going to create this kingdom on earth.
And we're going to do it in the way that you said, in terms of uniformity and heterogeneity. So that's where I think that the Kantian model, which was the model that then became was inherited by Hegel and then passed on and dominates the Kant modernity, is the dangerous, has its own unique dangers. And that's what I wanted to identify.
I just wanted, and maybe you sort of answered this to some extent, but I wanted to bounce off the first two comments. Let's start with the second, that there is a Rawlsian Hegelian school. It's small, but it does seem to be growing in some sense, in Europe anyway, and so it's coming back and forth. And that one connection is between the basic structure as a background and the Hegelian stress on objective spirit and recognition and all. So, I mean, it's not that can't be developed in Rawls with a little work. The second, and there are other points of contrast too. The other is to go back to this ideal, non-ideal, because I don't see how you can do non-ideal without some sense of ideal theory, conception of the person. And it seems to me you do need to develop beyond the Kantian conception of the person. Not that means end. I mean, that's in, for instance, feminists are saying maybe some faculties are missing in this traditional male, you know, conception of the person.
Sure,
so it seems to me important that you're also doing, while corrective, some alteration of at least, and this doesn't mean the person is eternally unchanging. It's not in Rawls either, and it's not in, it's historically thrown up, but it seems also maybe, I mean, I guess there are theorists doing this in African philosophy, that what is the person missing? If you want equality of persons, there's still certain things missing in this tradition that you might want to, that's what you
So
it's ideal theory doesn't seem to be dispensable,
right,
in my view, at least a minimal.
Okay, so crucial point again. And about the reason that I think the debate about this is so problematic is because you have such a kind of semantic buzz coming from, you know, the notion of ideal, non-ideal. All these terms are used with lay sense or Rawlsian sense, so that, you know, you know, just like some people are talking past each other. When I say I'm doing non-ideal theory, it's not that I'm dispensing with ideals. I'm using ideas in a different context. I'm doing normative theory in a non-ideal context. Normative theory always requires ideas. But I mean, the way these ideas are applied is going to be different, because what you're now trying to do is correct for injustices. So non-ideal theory in Rawls covers a whole bunch of stuff. There's conscience objection, there's just war, there's punishment, and so forth. I'm focusing on a phrase which I believe, if I'm wrong, please correct me, because I have probably written this down somewhere wrongly in that case, compensatory justice. So if you blink, you miss it. Rawls talks on about page 4 or 5 about compensatory justice in one of those matters of non-ideal theory. So I'm picking up on a phrase which I believe he never mentions again, and I'm basically saying that we need to develop this side of Rawls, because this is a side that's going to cover such issues in the case of race, affirmative action, preferential admissions, reparations. All of this comes down to compensatory justice for him. I mean, if I'm reading it right. And it then means that what you're doing is you're asking yourself, okay, what is morally appropriate in a situation where an injustice has been done and you want to correct for that injustice? And Rawls does not give us much information. He talks briefly, saying that the priority ordering of the two principles of justice should be emulated in sort of non-ideal theory, and I'm taking that to mean that principles of corrective justice should follow that ordering. And in another paper, which, you know, I don't have it, because obviously there's a link to what we can cover, I've argued that we can sort of use this to formulate tentatively what Rawls and principles of corrective justice would look like. And my argument there is that if you focus on Rawls' two principles, then the way to go is the following. So this is from memory. Okay, so Rawls' principles, first principle, basic liberties, lexically ordered, second principle, fair equality of opportunity over the difference principle. Corrective justice is going to be, as I phrase it in this paper, correction for the illicit advantage that whites have because of white supremacy. So Rawls, briefly, when he's trying to sort of show the continuity of what he's doing with the classical tradition, he says, look, this might seem weird, but in Aristotle there's this conception of pleonexia, where you're taking more than is your due, and you know, pleonexia covers a whole range of things, and you know, and basically sort of, you know, showing you won't avoid that, so there is this link. So my argument is, you can sort of use this and say whites are guilty of racial pleonexia, in the sense that they've got an illicit advantage in all these areas, both materially and in terms of sort of, you know, their legal status in the polity, and of course in terms of differential respect. And I then say, let's call the illicit white advantage a delta, so I'm sort of drawing on a sort of delta, the delta as an increase. So I then say that what we want to do in principles of corrective justice is correction for the illicit delta advantage whites have, or in everyday language, white privilege, and white privilege here is going to be a very heterogeneous category. It's going to cover white privilege in terms of the economy, the whites having more money. It's going to cover white privilege in terms of their legal standing. It's going to cover white privilege in terms of respect and so forth. So it means it's going to be a very heterogeneous category, but it has virtue of linking up with everyday discourse and of sort of uniting under this one term the sort of manifestations of the unfairness of a white supremacist society. And I then go on to argue that principles of corrective justice would basically involve correcting for the differential advantage whites have in the basic freedoms, because these are lexically ordered over the others, and correcting for the differential advantage that whites have in opportunities, and you know, you drop the difference principle, because the difference principle has never been applied in an actual society, and you're correcting for what has actually been taking place. So you then get principles of justice, and you know, the argument then is that this is the appropriate way to go. And I compare the route I take with two important attempts to sort of use Rawls to discuss these issues. An essay by Tommy Shelby that appeared in 2004 in Fordham Law Review, where Tommy basically argues that some people, such as Charles Mills, claim, you know, Rawls does not deal with these issues, but I mean, Mills is unfair because, look, Rawls gives us fair equality of opportunity, and if you press hard on fair equality of opportunity, you can develop it to deal with race. And a more recent article appeared in Ethics 2009, Rawls in Affirmative Action, Robert Taylor, I think, and he also argues that use fair equality of opportunity, and you can then ask the question of, you know, whether you can get affirmative action out of it. And his conclusion is actually a negative one, that you can only get the weaker kinds of affirmative action, and that people assumed all along that though Rawls didn't talk about affirmative action, you could get strong affirmative action out of Rawls if you tried. He's saying those people are wrong. You can only get very weak affirmative action, and stronger forms of affirmative action you can't get. Anyway, so the basic point I'm making is that two theorists, both trying to sort of use Rawls, sort of look at corrective justice, and they figure you have to use fair equality of opportunity. So we're then assuming that if Rawls thinks it's morally arbitrary, that, you know, people should be advantaged by how smart they are, or in what class they're born into, then this applies for race. And my claim is that both Tommy and, you know, this guy Taylor, they're both wrong. They're both committing a category mistake, because what they're doing, they're using principles of distributive justice, and they're trying to use these principles to do corrective justice. So what I then do is I sort of set up, you know, okay, say, here are the two principles, and here are my principles of corrective justice, and the principles of corrective justice don't involve using fair equality of opportunity. What they do is they correct for, you know, the illicitly expanded liberties of whites and the illicitly expanded opportunities of whites. And I use as my concrete example Sherrod Harris's famous article, Whiteness as Property, which appeared about 20 years ago. And what Harris argues is that in the US context, which is of course a polity based on private property, John Locke is a patron saint, whiteness has in effect functioned as property, in the sense not merely of differential advantages, but the sense of a set of legitimized expectations. A white person, you're supposed to have an edge that's part of the territory. And I argue that you can sort of look at this and then sort of apply my principles to it, so that, you know, the lexical order of the basic liberties of equality of opportunity, the standard argument that, you know, white conservatives give, affirmative action is infringing on my basic rights, the argument would then be they're not infringing on your basic rights, they're correcting for the illicit, the delta, the illicit advantage you have had in these rights and freedoms, the sort of illicit whiteness as property, and you weren't entitled to it in the first place. So, you know, it would help if I actually had the handout to give you, but, you know, you don't want any further trees on the planet level because of my desire to have handouts. But I do have an elaborate argument elsewhere that, you know, it's not a matter of not using ideals, but using ideals in this different context.
My question's for Robert. You focus more on the kind of scientific concept of race, it seems like, the idea of inheritable traits, etc. I was wondering if you kind of comment on what I see as a sort of implicitly racist task for philosophy that Kant sees in his philosophy of history. Turning back towards the idea for universal history, which I think is his most explicit attempt to align his anthropology and history, which of course spans his entire career with his mature critical thought and idea of philosophy in that sense. So the passage you quoted, which of course is about each succeeding generation kind of sacrificing themselves towards the overall progress, doesn't necessarily have to do with consciousness of that task. In other words, empirical history is always something unintelligible and messy. So his critique of the Tahitians, for example, in the review of Herder's book, is not just that they're lazy, but that they don't have any reason to be industrious because they're just interested in perpetuating their lives, right? So there's a kind of cyclical idea of time that he's criticizing as well. So it seems that the task for philosophy, because the task for philosophy that he outlines in the idea for universal history, is to be able to see the unfolding of providence, as it were, by looking at history in the large, right? That is, by assuring the individual of their kind of moral self-rectitude. And that seems to be sort of bringing to consciousness the kind of task of the Protestant, you know, work ethic, which might not otherwise belong to them. So in the conjectural beginning of human history, for example, he says that the unthinking human being feels, or the thinking human being feels a sorrow, which the unthinking human being doesn't, at you know, the fact that they can't see this unfolding product. So it seems that philosophy actually has a task in Kant's thought for sort of assuring the privilege of this, call it like European Protestant, you know, work ethic or something like that.
Yeah. Thank you. You're absolutely right to make the distinction, perhaps I wasn't clear enough about that, that I think that Kant is the source of the two of the dominant racisms of the 19th century, both the scientific racism and the historical, the philosophy of history racism, and that these are in some way separable and were separable. You know, if you look at Gobineau is in of the philosophy of history, Kant, but not so much of the scientific racism. I mean, Kant is more of a racial essentialist than Gobineau ever was. But on this other issue you raised, which I think is a really fascinating one, about how there is this tension in Kant's philosophy of history between the providence of nature, the foresight of nature, which is this idea he introduces already in 1775, and 1777 becomes the solicitude of nature, which is operating through history, as you say, unwittingly, unthinkingly, where corresponding to it. But then that is the way I see it, both in through the 1784 essay, but still 1795 in Perpetual Peace, is that there is a conflict between the working of nature, which is what is going to take us to this cosmopolitan home, and the morality. And until a later stage in the process, the morality is actually interfering with nature. So even though we are supposed to be doing the right thing, fortunately, that won't interfere with nature, which still wants unsocial sociability. It still needs war. It still needs genocides in order to reach its aim. And so it's only much later that when we reach this state, we are going to find ourselves in this cosmopolitan order which corresponds to the moral religion. But up until that point, our morality is confusing us in some ways and interfering with nature's operation. So that's why, you know, I puzzle about all this. But let me not go there.
Next, I've got Linda Arkut, and then after something. It's been a great exchange. I wanted to go back to this question of the relationship to the history of philosophy, or the history of European philosophy, I should say. Charles, I appreciated your response to Bob and Jay's question, because you're saying you want to put this in a way, you're using non-ideal methods to cast your own project, to think about your own project. So separating philosophical and strategic considerations is a holdover of ideal methods, and to do a non-ideal method is to make strategic considerations germane to these questions. But although there are the strategic considerations that you outline positively in the terms of the dominant discourse, there's other strategic effects that are also no doubt occurring when we frame normative theory under rubrics of Kant or Hegel for that matter, right? There's also, we're feeding the beast.
Yes,
we're feeding the beast.
Oh, feeding the beast.
The eschatological beast, the beast of Eurocentrism, of doing all the work that we need to do on Rawls and Kant to find, you know, the help for our non-ideal projects. I mean, just imagine people did that work with Fanon or Du Bois. I mean, you could get so much from them that would take a lot less work. Then we have to do flips to get it out of a page of Kant and Rawls. And when we do those flips, we are supporting that idea that this is the greatest conversation, this is where, you know, the greatest place to go for our norms will be. So obviously I'm not making a reductive argument. It's not because they're white guys, right? But there is this implicit idea in our non-ideal profession that this is the developmental vanguard of the greatest conversation of human beings. And so those of us who want to do social justice need to get into this. So although there's the one strategic effect you rightly described, there is this other strategic effect. And so what do we do with that? And I'm curious about both of your thoughts on this.
Well, you could think of it in terms of contingent circumstances. What do you think the best way forward is at a particular time? So we can sort of put forward as black radical Kantianism now. We establish a beachhead, get a bunch of folks of color in there, drop Kantianism then, and sort of say, well, actually, it was Fanon all along with the book. And that's putting it down somewhat cynically. Just in terms of trying to dialogue with people, I mean, and this is and you have been in a very active institutional and in your own work in issues of diversity and trying to sort of broaden the receptivity for these ideas. I take the point that you're sort of doing all not you. I mean, what I'm trying to do, I'm sort of going through all this work, sort of trying to say, look, these guys are doing something that the person you should be interested to. You're the personhood guy, so we're going to sort of put this all under Kantianism because you're the personhood guy, despite the fact that the really interesting work on sort of affirmation of subpersons, the black is not a man, the zone of non-being, whenever I went to, that's not in Kant, that's in all these other folks. So you could certainly say that there's a danger where you're trying to sort of transform the mainstream, and the mainstream is recuperating what you're doing and say, well, it's really in Kant all along. That if you just sort of, looked at paragraph this on page 522, you can just sort of spin out the implications of that. You don't need Fanon or Anna Julia Cooper or any of these folks. So the norm then, I guess, would be, the ideal would be to put this forward as an agenda on terms of reciprocal respect. That would be the ideal, even if the way it comes off might not seem that way, and say, you're engaged in this conversation of personhood, and the vast white majority of the profession are primarily concerned with this. But the real important is some personhood and those whose persons have not been recognized. That's really important, you see. And there's a whole bunch of other folks who have been doing this all along and not recognized as philosophers. Let's get a dialogue going. And within that dialogue, you need to sort of respect the work that has been done by these folks and to recognize it's been done in much more difficult conditions. It hasn't been done in the university lecture halls. It's with people out on the streets. It's people organizing. It's people, you know, struggling against segregation. And you know, this work sort of, you know, demands an intellectual respect from you in terms of its political significance and in terms of its insights. So that, you know, it's not the case that you can just sort of derive these insights sort of straightforward way from what Kant was doing. Nonetheless, I'm still trying to sort of claim that to establish lingua franca, that's the phrase I use, a sort of concept, common conceptual denominator, insofar as we're all human beings together on the planet, it is the sort of same thing in a sense, in that it's a recognition of, you know, the importance of persons. I mean, the whole question of here, of course, of non-human animals, which I haven't got into, but focusing just on us, the human population. There are these very interesting and important issues and sort of, you know, life and death debates about personhood, and you, the white guys who control the profession, you need to recognize that this important dialogue has been going on here. And there's going to be danger that we appropriate, there's the danger that they say, yeah, we knew it all along, because look, as I said, it's all sort of implicit in this. So you then have to do it in such a way that you're simultaneously battling against that appropriation.
Charles, this is very charming. But you have to choose who you're going to have the dialogue with.
Okay.
I chose a long time ago not to have the dialogue with these people because I saw where it led, and I don't have that much time to waste. I would love to have a dialogue with Charles Mills, but every time I hear Charles Mills talk, he's talking about roles. I don't understand why. Why can't you and I talk about the issues about the reality of racism in this country instead of talking about cantables? And you know, your explanation of why we should do this is because liberalism has historically been the dominant political philosophy in the country. And that is, to me, an explanation of why we need to have a full critique of liberalism, not an engagement with it or a dialogue with it, because we've seen where it leads. It seems to me you do prove, or perhaps you have a good argument, that it's not oxymoronic to talk about a black radical Kantianism, but when at the bottom of page 9 you say there's an imperative of developing a black radical liberalism, I worry about this. Is this the old Kantian thing that we now, everybody's got to do this? You're going to impose this even on people who don't particularly want
directives
to be liberal?
Directives will be issued tomorrow morning.
Exactly. And that's your old style Kantianism. But the only radical moment in your paper, it seemed to me, was in the penultimate sentence, which is that you say this black radical Kantianism should be equally uncompromising. Now, in its commitment, equally uncompromising as Kant. So I gave you the three possibilities that Kant had for being uncompromising, and I want to know which of these uncompromising alternatives you'll go, they're free, so they're not alternatives, but the three possibilities you're going to embrace. Do you want to enslave the white people? Do you want to kill them? Or do you want to assimilate them to black culture? Those are your choices. That is
Whoa.
There are only three possibilities?
Well, those are the three I gave him.
First, you want us to get away from Kant, then you're a trap if it's a three Kantian possibility.
He wants to be compromising in the Kantian way. That is what he committed himself to.
We'll have to take this under advisement, Bob. This is a serious decision with all kinds of implications, so I don't want to rush into it. So I'll get back to you in the next day or two.
Okay, thank you.
So, Charles, I see the advantages of, you know, some strategic advantages of going with a Kantian ideal theory, but picking up on some of the themes that others have said, I'm a feminist, anti-racist, anti-liberal,
sure.
And it's because I reject moral individualism, and I think I reject it both as a philosophical view and strategically because I don't think it helps us settle the crucial issues of the day. What do you do about pregnant women? What do you do about the severely disabled? What do you do about the environment? What do you do about non-human animals you mentioned?
Sure.
These are pressing issues of the day, and I think you can't address those issues with a moral individualism. I think we have to begin to recognize the value of relationships, the value, I mean, this, some of it is connected to the Nussbaum stuff and the Nussbaum critique,
yes,
of contract theory.
Sure.
And so when I'm in my polemical mode, even though you know I have tremendous, I want to say this is a moral theory for able-bodied males, including black or other racialized able-bodied males, but we still are talking about a moral theory for able-bodied males. So that's the polemical statement of it, but you know, it's all in the...
Dead wrong, but respectful.
No, in a Kantian sense. No, but I do think that moral individualism is really pernicious.
Pernicious, well.
Yes.
Oh, sorry, you want a response? okay. The move Rawls himself makes, as you know, is not to deny that issues of our relations with nature are important. He just says, in a sort of tradition in terms of contract theory, that's been covered by other stuff. So I, John Rawls, and folks on this stuff, and also other stuff support, you know, sort of other stuff. So I wasn't necessarily claiming it's a sort of comprehensive theory. And certainly insofar as issues of, you know, animal rights and the environment are not addressed at all here, and of course Kant's own position was a very backward one, as we know, you know, that sort of, you know, was not the focus there. So I was sort of, you know, focusing on the human population and sort of bracketing these issues of, you know, relation to the environment and so forth. I guess I'd need more persuasion to see why focusing just on the human population, moral individualism, is pernicious.
Pregnant women?
Pregnant women, okay.
The severely disabled.
Yeah, okay, well,
these are really serious moral questions,
yeah,
that we have, and who are the persons here, you know?
Who come to the persons, and...
Because it's about, I think that moral individualism is about non-dependent.
Non-dependent persons,
persons.
I see.
And
that,
I think,
yeah,
that when you have serious relations of dependency, then you get into serious...
Yeah, okay.
Because then what happens is you come along and say, the fetus is or is not a person, the severely disabled are or
okay,
not persons, the seriously,
yeah,
mentally ill, they are or not persons, the criminals, you know, I mean, we just sort of, the question of who counts as a person becomes,
yeah,
the serious question, and then you're drawing a line between the person and the non-person, which one has value. I think that's a dead end.
Okay, the challenge from disability, I must confess, I have not looked at. The primary focus of the paper, as you know, sort of, you know, coming out of my work on race, as the question of racial justice and sort of best strategies for that. To the extent that there are all kinds of other questions.
No, but intersectionality brings you up. Black women are pregnant too.
Oh,
black
people absolutely,
are severely
absolutely
disabled.
But
too.
See, when it's the case that, you know, you don't have an extensive body of literature dealing with race, you know, there's a limit to which you can sort of handle everything all at once, obviously. It's not the case that there's a large body of work in the roles and literature and race is part of the point I've made repeatedly. So, I mean, Bob doesn't think it's worthwhile getting your foot in the door, that's looking at the image. But if you want to sort of get your foot in the door, you sort of have to start somewhere. So, you know, starting off with race, racial justice, there are, in fact, you know, other people, Eva Kitte, of course, has done stuff on disability. I sort of saw, given that there's so few of us in the profession working on race, I didn't think it was illegitimate to sort of say, okay, let's sort of start with this, sort of see how far we can get with that, bearing in mind that it's not supposed to be a sort of all-encompassing, sort of self-sufficient body of theory that sort of basically settles every moral question. So I was sort of taken in that kind of spirit. What's the sort of best way to advance a racial justice agenda within the philosophical framework? As you correctly pointed out, of course, races themselves have genders, have disabilities, and so forth. But as a sort of starting point, sort of to get things off the ground, I thought, well, let's sort of go with this. Complications can come later.
You have 5 minutes to question.
Okay. So you make a moral and strategic argument for non-ideal theory.
Yes.
But I guess one, like my first point is that what I found missing in the paper was you talk a lot about Kant and you talk, sort of rectify Kant's project and appropriate him for your ends.
Yes.
And if I'm correct, your end is social change. But there's no talk of Marx or a radical Marxian project.
Marx is in there because I think
he's mentioned.
There's Kant, Marx, and Bonds.
Of course, he's mentioned, but I don't think you go into him enough. I guess my second point, and this is what I would like to focus on, is that in your article on white ignorance, you talk about white ignorance as a positive epistemic power that influences and asserts hegemonic force on social relations, particularly on the subjectivities engendered within societies under colonial and white supremacist domination, which at this point we could talk about the entire globe, the United States.
Certainly the good old USA, absolutely.
Yeah, the good old US.
Let ignorance reign supreme,
And then you talk about how finally institutions such as Harvard are talking about these issues and are publishing. So I feel like going off Professor Alcock's point, you're sort of you're privileging the intellectual above the person on the street in a certain sense. You're like, we need to have this conversation in this setting out here so that it permeates down to the street where social change and social movements take place. So that's sort of epistemically privileging the intellectual, and obviously the intellectual or higher education within the United States is largely composed of a white masculine population.
Sure.
So I'm a little torn about whether this is the strategic move to make if the end goal is to actually make social change, or if there are other better ways, better being the problematic word choice here, to effect social change without a recourse to Kant and Rawls and Western philosophy that is tinged with racism, colonialism, and domination at its very core.
Okay. You have systems of domination, you have constraining structures, but as you know, you also have points of resistance, you have oppositional movements. You have a larger white academy, in many ways a conservative academy, but you also have progressive women's academy, including white people, you have white anti-racists, you have male anti-sexists. So it's a matter of an ideological struggle. In other words, the history of, the rising of ideology, an adversarial approach, ideological state apparatus, no room for resistance, and then you have a competing approach from, Gramsci.
Yeah.
Gramsci says this stuff is never over and done with, you sort of try to develop a counter-hegemonic thing, and you try to sort of undermine it. This language is now antiquated, but who knows, it might be coming back. Anyway, so in that spirit, I see progressives in the academy, such as I see most people here are engaged in that kind of project. You're trying to sort of develop these oppositional ideas, and your hope is that they have a resonance out there. And it's also the case that there should be a kind of dialogue between people within the academy and outside, though of course there hasn't been much of that lately, as we know. So I think there's no contradiction by simultaneously affirming sort of the power of white ignorance, over all kinds of folks, and at the same time that there are people trying to undermine white ignorance. And I would like to think that this is a sort of small gesture on my part in that direction, and that you try to reach your students, you try to reach your audience you're talking to, and part of my point of sort of emphasizing liberal theory and this old-fashioned discourse of rights and so forth, this is what resonates on the street. I mean, if you look at the people demonstrating, the case of police killings of blacks, my rights have been violated, I can't breathe. So in this kind of language, the language of Percival, the language of liberal theory, of rights and so forth, is very much not an elite discourse alone. It also resonates on the popular level. So I see the kind of product I'm engaging in as having a greater potentiality for being taken up out there in a society which in a sense, sort of the idea of a contract, resonates very well considering relatively youth of the United States. It sort of have a discrete point in time where it is formed, as against some European countries, sort of goes back thousands of years. So the idea of a contract, and my claim would guide the actual contract, is a racial contract, that's unfair, there's certain rights we should have, you know, we have not had them. I see this virtue of this language, as I say, not merely having its intrinsic value for the reasons that we discussed, or the person and so forth, but also as having a greater capacity for resonating with a sort of mass population than other kinds of discourse, and let us say a Foucauldian discourse or a Hegelian discourse. So it seems to me that if you really want to create an effective mass movement for social change, you do need to take seriously what kind of language you're going to be using, where people's heads are, and what the national tradition is. The national tradition is the liberal tradition. I mean, Roger Smith documents this in great detail. So it's going to be strategically more effective, I think. You can sort of get these ideas of liberal framework and say, if you're a good liberal, you should be committed to this, as against saying, done with liberalism, here's our competing ideology. They say, but you know, why should we buy that? Well, in this case, I can say, you should buy it because you're a liberal.